Good morning, everybody. Today is Good Friday, as we remember the sacrifice, the death of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It might seem rather strange that it's called Good Friday, but as Pastor Kevin reminded us, the team this morning, Sunday is coming, and this is all very good news. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 says this, marvelous words, beloved, how great is the love that the Father has lavished on us. Strong words the Lord has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God. And folks, this is what we are. New Creation Church, Heartland, a church connected together today. This is what we are, the children of God. In spite of anything that might be going on in our lives or our minds today, you are His beloved child. Would you stand with me, please? Heavenly Father, thank you for the truth of your word, that we are your children, your beloved daughters and sons. We give you praise for that. And Father, as we worship you today, as we hear in wonderful fashion the truth of your word from our general superintendent, Lord, I ask that you would touch our hearts and our minds by your spirit, that you would encourage your people, that they would know that they are beloved of God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Worship team, God bless you as you bless the Lord.
Love so
healer, my greatest doctor, my life is Jesus. Ask me,
Hallelujah. Before I read the word of God, I just want to say sorry a while ago. I was so bothered for what's going on to my wife, because during that time I'm doing the sound check before, because before I was a pastor, and before I became a pastor, I am one of the sound tech in our church. And while I'm wearing a headphone and doing the sound check during that time, doing live stream, I heard the sound in my ear closing the wireless to her heart. It's like, you know, if you watch Star Wars, the sound is like that. Ooh. And every time she put it down, nothing. And every time she put it up, ooh. And she said this, she's feel dizzy. That's why I was so worried a while ago, because she might faint. You know, when we are our home, my wife take care of us. But outside, we should be the protector, right? So I'm sorry about that. But right now, let me read you a scripture. In Romans chapter 6, verse 4 to 7 said, "We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The picture today is a celebration what Christ did on the cross 2,000 years ago. We are dead to sin. Three things: dead to sin, we are love, and lastly, you became victorious. Three weeks ago, I have preached about it is finished. And I said to them, to those who accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, you don't need breakthrough. Those who need breakthrough, they need a break-in. But those who accepted the Lord, you are already victorious. We are victorious in Christ. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your voice to the Lord. Hallelujah. We glorify your name. We are your highly exalted Lord. This is your people, oh God. This is the picture in heaven, worshiping for your glory name, diversity. Your kingdom come, Lord, as is in heaven, oh God. You're holy, you're gracious. Thank you for your love. We honor you. We praise you, Lord. Ora bastante. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. We thank you so much for freeing us from sin. Thank you so much for the love. And thank you so much, oh Lord, for the victory. We honor you, we glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen.
Thank you. I've been here a month. I think I know how to turn a microphone on right now. Thank you, choir and Pastor Nick. Let's thank them once again. Thank you for the time and effort to bless God's people today. Thank you so much. Really enjoyed that bass playing as well. You're not bad. You're real good. It is my great honor and truly a delight today to introduce to you the Reverend Dr. David Wells. For the past 16 years, almost, he has served as the General Superintendent of Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada. That's a long time. I'll bet you sometimes you felt it's a long time as well, on some days, I'm sure. Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada is a group of about 12,000 churches right across Canada, and it's a wonderful organization that has blessed so many, and he serves as our superintendent. Because of this, there are some international interactions that Pastor David has. He serves as the president of the Pentecostal Charismatic Churches of North America. He's the vice chair of the Pentecostal World Fellowship and chairs this organization's Christian Unity Commission. He is well prepared for these roles. He completed his undergraduate studies in theology at Vanguard College in Edmonton, Alberta. He has his Master of Arts in Christian Ministry from Briarcrest Seminary in Saskatchewan. And he has been awarded not one, not two, but three honorary Doctorate of Divinity degrees from McMaster Divinity College, Briarcrest Biblical Seminary, and by the Pentecostal Bible and Leadership Institute in Malawi, Africa. He chairs the Educational Standards Committee of the PAOC. Not only this, and be prepared to be amazed, he has participated in 6 Olympic Games. He really has. You wonder what event? The chaplaincy department of the Olympic Games. I did need to tell them that, Pastor. I needed to throw that in, which is a remarkable, remarkable honor and accomplishment. Listen to this, and this speaks to the outward focus, the evangelistic heart, the care for lost people that our speaker brings today. He has served in sports chaplaincy at 6 Olympic Games, 6 Commonwealth Games, and 2 Pan Am Games. He was the chair of the Multi-Faith Committee, which organized chaplaincy at the 2010 Olympic Games in Vancouver, I believe it was, and Paralympic Games, and at the Toronto 2015 Pan Am and Parapan Games, and at the Invictus Games in Toronto in 2017. You're quite a guy. This is an amazing man, is he not? I mean, God using him in all of these ways. He's just returned from the Philippines, by the way, you should know. Jet lag is still in place, so if there's a mishap today, we understand, Pastor. We understand jet lag. This is all wonderful material, but what I'm about to share with you, in my opinion, is really the most significant. David and his wife, Susan, and welcome today to you, Susan. Thank you for your service to the Kingdom of God, and more specifically, the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada, which probably is so often unseen, but today is acknowledged and appreciated. I feel moved in my spirit. Thank you. David and his wife, Susan, who's also an active speaker and writer, live in Burlington. They have 3 children, Shannon, who's married to Eric, Jonathan, who is married to Melissa and is here today, and Jordan and Justine. Even more significantly, sorry kids, they have 8 grandchildren. Now that's significant, but what I'm about to share with you actually came from the pen of Pastor David, or his ghostwriter, I'm not sure. But here it is. They have 8 grandchildren, and here's what really struck me. One of whom is in heaven. That is significant. So I'm thinking, and we've talked about the Reverend Dr. David Wells and Susan, but hey, brother and sister, Easter weekend must have special, special significance to you, given that fact. Wow. And I don't know how many years ago this happened, but that this child went to heaven, but here you are faithfully and joyfully serving the Lord, and that's remarkable. And I'm sure that's been a journey in itself, but we honor you today, and we thank God for your faithful service, even in that difficult, most life-changing, difficult situation, and I'm sure there have been others, but we honor you today for that, and to me that's the most important thing in this autobiography, all the great accomplishments, your faithfulness, spite of very, very hard times. So we thank you. Would you please just give this family, Pastor David, as he comes, a warm, warm, wonderful welcome.
Thank you. Thanks, Pastor Scott. Oh, thank you, Pastor Scott. That was a very warm greeting, and everybody over there in my family section is trying to figure out who was he talking about. But anyways, it is such a privilege to be back at Heartland this morning, and we join you from time to time and just try to slip in. But the last time I tried to slip in, they said, next time you're coming, we want you to speak. And so I've been booked to be here with you for a year now, and looking forward to Good Friday 2024 to be with you at Heartland. So what a privilege to be here, and to be here with family. My son Jonathan, his wife Melissa, and the kids attend here, and so it's great to be with them again this morning. Today I want to invite you to come to the table as we consider the message of this weekend, Good Friday and Easter. We often, on their Good Friday services, take time to have communion together. I want us to think about what it really means to come to the Lord's table. And so I'm going to invite you to join with me, and I'm going to ask some others to join me over time to come to the table. I was privileged to grow up in a family of five kids, mom and dad, in Northeast Edmonton. Anyone been to Edmonton? All right, boy, we gotta get you people traveling. All right, so. And we grew up where my two younger brothers and I loved sports, and we'd go out across the street to Princeton Elementary, and we'd play our different sports. Put a football helmet on my one brother, youngest brother Jeff, and my other brother Ron, and I would kick the football to him and tell him to run. And, you know, he'd catch the ball, and then he had to run at his two older brothers. Of course, it was just an excuse to pound on your younger brother, because we call it football, but we all know what it is. Now, Jonathan plays rugby. It's the same idea, right? You just brutalize the person. And so we'd be out there playing football, sometimes baseball, sometimes soccer. That was just our lifestyle. But then all of a sudden at 13028 78th Street, the turquoise house, the door would open, and you'd hear this little voice, "Boys, come for supper. Come now." Well, that was Ruth. That was my mom. And of course, like three boys are prone to do, you just ignored it, right? You went back to kicking the ball and pounding your little brother and just having a great time. But all of a sudden, we'd hear this other voice, "Boys, come now. Get up to the table." Well, that was Ralph. And you listened to Ralph. So we'd scramble in and get, you know, washed up, and we'd all gather at the family table, and we all had our place. Head of the table was my dad, of course, and I had the privilege of sitting at the right hand of the Father. It was actually a very intentional positioning. The girls had to be separated from one another. They still kind of got to be separated even today from each other. But anyways, we won't go into family issues right now. But, you put Carolyn over there and Kathy over there. Us boys got along great because we got it all out on the football field, right? So, and I'd be sitting there. Well, I had an imaginative mind, and as you heard, I love sports, involvement with sports. So I would see stuff like, those dreaded Brussels sprouts on my plate, and I just figured, well, you know, they look more like basketballs to me, you know. And I don't know if any of you grew up in homes in kind of some of these suburban 1960s homes, but they had light standards that were shaped like a triangle. And they had three lights hanging down over the dining room table. So as you sat there, that looked to me like a basketball hoop. And, you know, the first couple times that a Brussels sprout went through the basketball hoop, that was it for me getting away with that. Because suddenly the hand of the Father would swing across and say, like I said, I was stationed here very strategically by my Father. I love hockey. Here we go, Oilers, here we go. So anyways, I got to be true to Edmonton. Sorry if anybody are Maple Leaf fans. Like, I'm really sorry if any of you are Maple Leaf fans. But anyways, I just, if you take mashed potatoes and form them into goals, and you use your peas as pucks, you can have your own great hockey game going on your dime. And you know what happened? The right hand of the Father, and, well, you know, my 3 years ago today on Good Friday, my dad went to be with Jesus, and I was with him in Edmonton when he suddenly passed away. My mom went to be with Jesus in 2016. My next oldest brother went to be with Jesus in 2006. He battled with Lou Gehrig's disease. You know, real life, real family. But you hear how I talk about the family table. Because something was put into place in that family table that's still with me to this very day. I belonged. I belonged. I knew the intimacy of a table. I knew a table where my mother, with her Danish background, just welcomed anybody at any time to come and be at the table. We never knew how many extra chairs we were going to have to get around the table, or how many people would drop in for coffee after church, or on and on the list goes, because that was my mom. You belonged. When she passed away and we had her memorial service a few years ago, the church, their home church, was packed with over 500 people who all referred to Mom Wells, because we belonged. That's the family table, a place of belonging, a place of sharing your story, a place of being known and knowing. And yeah, sometimes even some of the fault lines, and some of the challenges, but you share them together and you share them around the table. Well, we have a table to come to as well. And our Lord, in the parable of the wedding banquet in Matthew 22, it's set in the middle of several parables where the Lord is speaking just prior to the crucifixion, that holy week. The Lord is speaking very straightforwardly about the invitation to come and those who can come. But he's also challenging those who will not come and who will not listen. So he tells this parable in Matthew 22, that of the wedding banquet. And the invitation is, come to the table, come and dine. And Jesus describes it very realistically that many refused to come. They rebelled. They even attacked the messengers that would invite them to the king's table. The king says, those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you can find. Servants, gather all the people they could find. They went to the whosoevers. Anybody that knew they should come to the table, that wanted to belong to the table, the whoevers, the poor, the rich, whatever their backgrounds, male, female, they were welcomed at the Lord's tables. Jews, yes, but Samaritans, Gentile, come to the table, whoever, anyone you can find. Folks, when you come to the table today, I want you to know that God's desire has always been to gather a family to himself. He's always desired to have a family that would come to the table. The whoever's, wherever you're from, whatever your background, whatever the fault lines are, you can come to the table. And so he says to his disciples, I eagerly desire to eat the Passover with you. So he prepares a table for them. And he brings his disciples to the table. And it's at that table, as you read it, leading up to the first Good Friday, that he shares the deepest intimacies, like you do at a family table. He shares with them that he no longer calls them servants, but he calls them friends. And then he says, come, we're going to break bread together, but this is more than a meal. This is more than a Passover. This is what the Passover is all about. This bread really means something. My broken body. And this cup is the cup of the New Testament. This is the covenant that will go out from my sacrifice on the cross and my resurrection. There will be a message that will go around the entire planet for all that I've created, that you can come and you can be transformed by the work that I accomplish, by my broken body and my shed blood. I am the one, the unique one. Whoever wants to come through me may come and find life, life to the full. Jesus shares these things around bread and a cup, the family table. So the message still goes out to us. It goes out to us here in Canada. It goes out loud and clear. And it's to the whoever's may come. It's a diverse call. It's not exclusive. Whoever may come. And he calls us with our various callings, our various backgrounds. Pastor Scott, you've been called to the table. Do you mind coming to the table right now? Yeah. Now, we honor that the Lord has given gifts to the church, Ephesians 4, other places where it's emphasized. But at the table, it's never understood to be like this chair's up here and we're all down there. You know what I'm saying? When it comes to relationship with Jesus and being brothers in Christ and brothers and sisters in Christ, we all come to the same table. We all enter in the same way. And Pastor Scott, we thank you for coming to the table. We thank you for serving Jesus the way you do as a servant of the Lord, and understanding that your calling is lived out on behalf of the family of God. That's why you're at Heartland right now. Thanks to you and Kathy. So would you come to the table? See, the model for leadership in the family of God is rooted in the DNA of the kingdom. What's the DNA of the kingdom? The DNA of the kingdom is our Lord's DNA, where he emptied himself and he made himself of no reputation, and he took upon himself the form of a servant. And becoming like one of us, he emptied himself. No reputation, becomes a servant, and as a servant, he goes even to death, death on the cross. That's why this table is so important for all of us. No matter how we're gifted, no matter how we're called, we still follow a Lord who emptied himself and made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant. And fashioned like one of us, he was prepared to die, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalts. Therefore, God works through us in all of our giftings and callings. Therefore, all of us know the joy of being who Jesus calls us to be, from the youngest to the oldest. We serve the way we're called to serve him, but also to serve the body with the gifts we're given. Nobody's allowed to say, well, I don't have giftings. No. If you're hearing my voice today online and in person, you are gifted and called by God to serve him and serve his people and know the great joy of being like your Lord. All of you, you've got to come to the table. We come to the table together. And then we serve. But we serve with the kingdom DNA. Selfless, sacrificial service. No one lords it over the other. Selfless, sacrificial service. Philippians 2. We're agreed on that, aren't we?
We are agreed.
That's the DNA of the kingdom. That's how the family table expresses the unity of the body to a world that so desperately needs to belong at this table. I'm glad for the many people I've met in the life of the church who they bring their gifts to the table, my pastoral friends and others. But there's a friend in the church here that I've actually known since the previous century. We probably knew each other since the previous. Sounds really old, doesn't it? But I'm asking my colleague and friend Nick Eiderstrom to come forward tomorrow, this morning, and be at the table. Nick, you got the memo, didn't you? Where's Nick hiding out? Oh, he appeared! Nick, would you come to the table? Yeah. So, this guy was the IT guy at the POC before there was IT. How old are you? Anyways. But, you know, even dropping into Heartland recently, I see Nick up helping with worship with the gifts that he's got. I thank God for the Eiderstrom family and the way he was raised in a home where music was a gift to offer to God, not to lord it over others, but to bring glory to God. And to his sister is a great blessing in the life of the church as she teaches at Tyndale and uses her gifts. You know, it's just the whole body has to be at the table. And I honor Nick and your faithfulness, the way you've just stood by this stuff. Here we are, literally a quarter of a century later since you and I first met each other, and you're still showing up. You're still showing up, being who you're called to be. I just want you to hear it loud and clear. We honor you today.
Indeed.
And we thank you. And again, that's the calling to the whole body, to show up with what God gifts you with. And especially if you know IT, please show up. Because some of us are absolute Luddites and don't have a clue what's going on, you know. You're helping us out. I've got another dear colleague. We work together and a friend. I've just learned so much from by being partnered with her over the last number of years. And she's been attending here for about 3 years, helps out in worship when she can. But Stacy McKenzie, would you come to the table, please? Would you welcome Stacy? Stacy, yeah, is that all right? You and Nick get along? I should have asked first, right? Yeah. You never know, you know, on worship teams sometimes, it, you know, okay. Now, in a roundabout sort of way, I'm Stacy's boss. But it's very clear to me that the main relationship and the first relationship is she's my sister. And I'm her brother. Is that clear to you? Yeah. Good. Don't you be messing up my sermon now. Stacy is our publications manager. She is the editor for our national magazine, which is more than a hard copy magazine. It's really our multi-channel way of communicating to our constituency, communicating our messages. And say the message I'm communicating at this table today, Stacy has worked with me to ensure that our fellowship knows that it doesn't matter what your spiritual journey has been. My spiritual journey is diverse from Stacy's. Stacy comes from Trinidad and Tobago, came up into the United States and also Canada for education. And in that journey, you found Jesus, right? Came to living faith. And I can tell you, it's a very devout faith. It's a whole life, 100% sold out to Jesus faith. I mean, you don't want to have your principal communicator to your constituency to be anything other than fully devoted to Jesus. But there's also a diversity of perspective that Stacy brings that I don't have. Maybe you noticed, I'm not a black woman. And I don't say that lightly. We, especially in the Canadian church, have a wonderful opportunity to demonstrate what the kingdom of God is like from every tongue, tribe, and nation. From all of our backgrounds and all of our perspectives. But sometimes it's a painful journey to really understand what it's been like for someone else to live and belong when they're of a totally different background than you are. So I understand the great opportunities I've had as a young Canadian boy, my mom as a Danish immigrant's child, my family, my dad's family coming up from the U.S., but being raised as a white male throughout all these years, and to be so thankful to God. See, I think wherever you come from, it's that first posture is that I am just so grateful to God for the people he's brought in my life, for the places he's brought me, but to mutually respect that in the other as well. And to say the table of the Lord at Canada is very rich because how he's brought us from all the nations, male and female, with all of our backgrounds of how we came to Jesus and the gifts he gives us. And they can all be found at the table. So Stacy, I'm just so glad Jesus brought you to our table. And I honor you today. And I'm still your boss, but not a boss. I'm your brother and your co-laborer. And let's keep telling the world about Jesus together. And help me to keep learning. You've taught me so much, shared so much of your perspective, your journey, and I thank you for that. All right, Ethan, are you ready? You gonna bring your dad? Go get your dad. I'm asking Jonathan and Ethan to come to the table. Now, do you want to sit next to Stacy or next to Grandpa? Oh, all right. Well, Jonathan knows Stacy too. You heard me talk about my own family. Well, this is Ralph and Ruth's grandson. I guess that makes you my son. He's actually born in Hamilton, Ontario. Anyone else born in Hamilton? St. Joe's? Yeah. He got trapped in the birth canal. He didn't breathe for 5 minutes. And so Dad stood at the end of the bed while my wife was wrestling to even understand what was going on. And I was interceding in other languages, praying for this boy. And that's why he's named Jonathan, God's gracious gift. Jonathan David, beloved. Hope you know all the way through your life how loved you are. I've prayed for him every day of his life since 1982. Every day. Because I believe our kids have a calling from God and a purpose. And we want them to know that they're loved and that they belong and that we're proud. And my three kids are like a triangle as far as personalities and how they see life, and they get along, but they're all Susan and my kids. And God invites us to have intergenerational families that come to the table. We can trust God for that our sons and our daughters, and that our grandsons and granddaughters, Sophia Faye. They belong at the table. I don't want you to lose the passion, the heart, the belief that your sons and your daughters and your grandsons and granddaughters will be at the table. The Lord died so that we could see generations. And it's really my generation's responsibility to lay ourselves down and serve in such a way that our sons and our grandsons, our daughters and our granddaughters can rise and go way above and beyond anything we've ever seen. To be all that Jesus calls them to be, and to see happen in Canada what some of us have only prayed for and longed for, and to believe that our sons and our grandchildren will see it as well. So I pray a gift of faith across this room right now for each of you, for your families, for your sons, your daughters, your grandsons, your granddaughters, that they will be all that Jesus calls them to be. I pray for those that are wandering away from the table right now, that they'll hear the call of the Spirit, the Lord saying, come to the table. Come to the table. You're mine. You're called by my name. You're chosen by me. Come to the table. I'm just so happy these guys are at the table. I'm so proud. This guy has a gift of mercy and justice. He knows exactly what the great requirement is. He has shown you what the Lord requires of you, O man, to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with God. That's my son. That's my son who gives himself to Charis Ministries and for adults with extreme disabilities so that they can still know their value and know their life. That's my son who committed himself to Habitat for Humanity so that those who otherwise might not have housing, have a home, can know a home, you see. My son has a strong sense of justice that Brampton should be treated equally with the other suburbs in Toronto. You know, justice. Well, we serve a God whose pillars of his throne are righteousness and justice. And I'm so glad that God has put that in my son's heart to live out. His wife's amazing. Melissa, we're so proud of you. The gift of pouring into others that she has. Her pursuit of a graduate degree in education. Why? So she can serve others. So she can have help teachers and help parents to be on the same page about schooling. In an era when education in Canada is a maze, M-A-Z-E, right? Education in our schools and so on is just baffling. And the expectation that's put upon educators. But I thank God that Melissa and so many others are at the table who are living as sons and daughters of God to influence education, to influence parents and children. I honor you. And this guy and his sister, like, watch out. They're probably going to rule the world. Do you want to rule the world? And I thank Ethan and Sophia for helping Nana and I to see the world through their eyes. And just the privilege of being your grandpa. It's such a privilege to be your grandpa. And I'm so glad you're at the table. So this is a beautiful picture, isn't it? What the Lord desires. It could be any of you up here with us. It could be your story, your journey to be at the table, the gifts you bring. This is just a little snapshot of Heartland at the table. I feel bad that I don't have someone from the Philippines at the table since I was just there last Friday, you know, so all you Filipinos will forgive me for not, yeah. Yeah. We're all at the table. But the diversity is beautiful, but it's also the challenge of the table. Our diversity is like the first disciples, where even as Jesus is breaking the bread and giving them the cup, they're arguing about who's the greatest in the kingdom. Did you notice that in the passages related to the Lord's table on that first? See, there's so much that you have to keep bringing to the table. You have to constantly keep coming back and being broken and bringing our relationships to the table and letting our egos drop. So our Lord at the table took out a towel and took out a basin and demonstrated again that DNA that makes the kingdom operate, selfless, sacrificial service. Because if we make the church about ourselves, if we make the Christian life to have to run the way we see it, division will come to the table. And you hear the heart cry of Jesus in the Passion Week teachings like John 17, Father, bring them to complete unity so that the world will know that you have sent me. This table really matters. And whatever would pull us apart and whatever would divide, we have to constantly put it under and humble it to this table and to our Lord. True within our families, and it's true within relationships, and it's true within ministries in the life of the church, and it's true as we consider gifts of leadership within the life of the church. We keep bringing it to the table. And so, friends, I invite you to come to the table today. You received the cup, you received the wafer. I know you need a graduate degree in how to open those things up, but you know, you just peel the top layer, I think, would get you the wafer. Don't peel too deep or you get the cup, but then you can't get the wafer. Unless these are different kind of ones, but it's, yeah, is that. So we pause now for a commercial break about how to open your communion cup, anyway. I'm going to break bread with our friends up here, as so follow along with us, will you? The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And as he broke it, he said, "This is my body broken for you." Jesus said he's the bread of life. We all eat from the same loaf. We all have life because of the Lord, who in his brokenness gave himself for us so that we could know life and life to the full. We have a Lord who put himself in the way of the devourer and stood in the gate and didn't run like some hireling, but has our Lord and has the Creator, yet stood in the way. And he took upon himself all of the sin and all of the brokenness and all of the animosity and all the hatred of all time. He had it poured upon himself. He stood in the middle between the animosities that was there between the Jews and the Gentiles. So the different racial backgrounds and different religious backgrounds. He took it all, Ephesians says, upon himself. He stood in the middle. And he made peace. His broken body. So, Scott, I share the bread with you. And I honor the gift that you are to the family of God. Thank you for you and Kathy. And being faithful in your leadership gift for several decades now. Nick, I honor you and Tina. I honor the calling of God on your life and the way you've lived it out. And sometimes it's in a cubicle looking after IT things. I cannot tell you how important all your gifts are to the body of Christ. So true. Just show up. That's it. Thank you, Nick, for showing up year after year. Thank God for the DNA from your family, that gift of giving yourselves to the body. Don't stop. Don't lose heart. The Lord sees your sacrifices. He knows your heart. He honors it. Stacy, thank you for being my sister. Thank you for letting your light shine. First of all, your devoutness for Jesus. Thank you for that. That's the main thing. And out of that comes your heart to communicate and your heart to see the body in its diversity reflect the love of Jesus. Thank you. Bud, I'm so proud of you. Maybe I communicated that already. But I'm glad we're brothers in Christ. Like, that really matters to your mom and I, obviously. That's why I pray for you every day. Thanks for persevering through those seasons of doubt and asking the hard questions. But I honor you for doing that because the faith's real, and you know the commitment you've made. And thanks for sharing that with my grandson. Ethan, I'm so glad to be your grandpa, but I'm also glad to be, you know, we're brothers in Jesus. Weird, eh? A grandpa who's also a brother. And just like your daddy and mama and your nana and grandpa, we want you to know Jesus' life and for you to be all that Jesus wants you to be. I think you're going to be a leader. You are real gifts from the Lord. So we break bread together. We honor one another. But more than anyone, we honor our Lord who is willing to be broken for us and pay the price, that out of his brokenness we could become one. Let's eat the bread together, shall we? And we take the cup together. This is the blood of that new covenant. Represents that there's no other way than Jesus, the one and only. We don't all just by accident end up in heaven together. We come through Christ. He made that very clear himself. No one comes to the Father but by me. And there may be some here this morning that you've never come to the family table and acknowledged Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life. As you join us at this table today, I invite you to come into that commitment, that covenant of relationship with him and say, Lord Jesus, I'm yours. I give myself 100% to you. You sacrificed, you died so that I could be set free and so that I could live. I receive that gift. Before we drink the cup, how many would put up their hands and say, yeah, that, I like all of us who have that commitment, would you put your hand up and say, I'm committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. At this table today, at the family table, I honor the Lord of the table, Jesus Christ, the one and only. Thank you that you wash away our sins, Lord. Even those who are committed to you like we are, Lord, even this week, we need fresh cleansing. We need you to purify our hearts, purify our thoughts. We need you to help us to maintain the unity and the bond of peace. So come, Lord Jesus, even as we drink this cup, and cleanse us and purify us and empower us by your Spirit for who you call us to be, both individually but also together as families and as the church. Lord, come, Lord Jesus. So we drink this cup together at the table. Would you stand with me, please? And let's just offer ourselves to the Lord in worship right now and say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for making a way for us to come to your table. Thank you for the invitation to come. Thank you that you invited us, the whoevers from all our backgrounds, Lord, imperfect lives that we've lived, and Lord, so many things that maybe the evil one would say you don't belong. But Lord, absolutely everyone in this room and online belongs at the table today because of your invitation. So we thank you. We stand amazed in the presence of Jesus and wonder how you could love us. Thank you, Lord. Even as sinners, you loved us so that we could be cleansed by you, so that we could be transformed by you, so that we could become like you. Lord, I pray blessing upon Heartland. May it truly be a church connected by this table, connected by their Lord, connected by the empowerment of the Spirit, connected, Lord, for your purpose to see your good news radiate out to this community and beyond. In Jesus' name, in power, from the youngest to the oldest, for each one to be who you call them to be. And Lord, like families, we may go out in the field and pound one another, but in the end, may we gather around the table and know that we are one in you, that we are family, and that we will lift up the name of Jesus together. This we ask in his great name. Amen. Pastor Nick.
Thank you.
No, Kevin.
I'm on the list.
Yeah.
Oh. Thank you, Pastor, for sharing today. I'm here to invite you to another time. We've had our people bring in, or many of you have brought in some food to share, and so I really want to invite you, especially after we've had this message about the body of Christ, made up of many parts, but we're all family. So we want to invite you to make your way. You can take your communion cup. The ushers will be at the back to collect those as well. But if you make your way and come down the big hallway, there's double doors into the gymnasium. Tables are set up there, refreshments. It's Good Friday. Not much is open. Would you take some time to visit with one another? Meet someone new. Encourage them in the Lord. And let this table continue as we fellowship together. Amen. I pray the Lord will bless you and keep you, your loved ones and family, and may He bless our time together as we share. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, go up and get
God
the
bless
cup.
You. Bless
your
you.
Cup, the one you have.
We'll see you Sunday morning here at 10 o'clock. Invite you, bring so someone you with you.
Yes.
No, we'll,
yeah.
Whatever, it's great to be here.
Whatever you're comfortable with, okay?
Yeah. We'll eventually enjoy a family meal, but...